when I became prime minister in 2019, no one thought that we would be faced with a war at the heart of the European continent. But this is what we have to deal with after Russia's unprovoked invasion of Ukraine. And I do believe that the alliance has adjusted and has tackled this momentous challenge as successfully as it could. Back in 2019, we were still faced with the question of whether enough European countries would meet the 2% commitment, 2% of defense spending as a percentage of GDP. Now, most countries have already met that target, and those that haven't have made very clear pledges that they will do so. Greece has been one of those countries that has surpassed the 2% threshold ever since, essentially, we joined the alliance. We'll be spending 3% of our GDP on defense, significantly modernizing our armed forces, and thus contributing to the overall capabilities of the alliance. So new challenges force us to think differently, also in terms of what this means for the collective European security as a pillar of the overall NATO integrated structure. And I think this discussion is advancing at a very fast pace in Europe. More, but we also need to be smarter about how we allocate our defense spendings. When I look at the European defense industry, I see a lot of fragmentation. I don't see enough interoperability. I see a lot of sometimes maybe, you know, I would say, I wouldn't say a necessary competition, but certainly too many weapons systems that don't necessarily talk to each other. Or a flagship European project, which would essentially be a European Iron Dome that would complement the existing air defense capabilities that we have, which could be, again, I stress the word could be because we clearly don't have agreement at this stage, which could be funded through some sort of European joint borrowing.
Get to the 2%, but also ways to increase capabilities and integrated capabilities.
And of course, also ways to strengthen also our European defense industry at a time when we talk a lot about strategic autonomy, when the issue of competitiveness is at the top of our agenda, bolstering European defense cooperation, European innovation. We've made some first steps at the European level in that direction, but we clearly need to do more. We need to look at the holes this has created to our own defense capabilities. And as much as we talk about sophisticated systems, we also need to make sure that we have the basics. I mean, Ukraine demonstrated how important, for example, 155 shells are, and that not everything is going to be sort of as technology-driven in a modern war as many people thought. So making sure that we also streamline production, strengthen our stockpiles, while at the same time having the capability to support Ukraine, this is a challenge that we have to meet.
What is your hope for the 75th public forum? What do you think, NATO, what would you like to see out of the 75th anniversary summit?
Well, first of all, I think it is important to take stock of what we have achieved. NATO has been successful because it has been able to adapt and occasionally even reinvent itself. And this is exactly what we need to do now. For me, the most crucial aspect of NATO has always been the strength of the transatlantic partnership. And I think it is very, very important that we maintain this this mutual commitment, but to also recognize that in an alliance, we all need to do our own part. There are no free riders, and that is why meeting the 2% commitment is so important, at least for those countries that have always been very consistent with this target. And maybe at some point we will need to discuss about raising it. Maybe 2% is not enough. Maybe we need to get to 2.5% if we really want to deliver everything we want to do within within the alliance. But you know, the one thing which is certain is that at a time of great uncertainty, being part of an alliance that is strong, defensive, and capable of defending us all against external threats is as important as it has ever been.